Use reducer is a hook that comes hand in hand with use context. Use context might be used on its own when the context doesn't contain a lot of states. However, when the context becomes bigger, we might need a reducer. Let's explore the use reducer hook and apply it on a concrete example. Before continuing, you'll need to have a basic concept of the use context hook. Head over to the use context section of this handbook to learn more about it. In short, use context is a hook used to save a state globally, available across the entire application. The use reducer is a hook that allows us to manage complex state logics. If you have used Redux before, the concept of a use reducer is pretty similar to Redux. A reducer basically is a switch statement defining all the possible actions a context can perform and only updating the part of the global state related to that action. So we can take a look at the use reducer here. You can see that it takes a reducer, which is the switch statement that I just mentioned. And we also have two other arguments, which is the initial argument, which means the initial state, as well as an init, which is optional. And you can see right here that we can access the state as well as a dispatch function, and it looks pretty similar to a use state. We'll take a deeper look at the use reducer later on in this video. Now, let's create a use context hook using use reducer with the example of an online shopping website. For this tutorial, I already created a startup project that you can find at this link here and is also available in the text content of this section. If you take a look at it, you'll see that we have in the app.js file a router at the bottom here, and we also have links to two different pages in this project. So our homepage as well as a cart page. The homepage is the products component that you can find in this project. And you can see that we are simply iterating over the shop data, which is an array of products that you can find in the shop data file. And for each product, we're displaying a product card. And a product card look like this with an add button here, an image of the product, the name of the product, as well as its price. In the cart component, we only have a title for now. So let's click on cart here. And you can see that we just have the title, which is the total amount of the user's cart. We'll be updating this project, so I highly encourage you to fork it, which is the button next to the share button, and we'll create a use context with use reducer on top of it. Now we'll need to create a context. This context will allow us to access the elements the user added to the cart across the entire application. So first, we will create a new file, and this file will be called shopcontext.js. At the top, we'll import createContext from the React library. Below that, we'll use this create function and create a context. So we'll do createContext with parentheses at the end. And let's save it in a variable called shopContext. If you hover over createContext, you can see that it needs a default value, and it can be any type of data. We will create an initial value of our context in a shopReducer file. So let's create another file, and we'll call it shopReducer.js. By convention, the reducer file should always start with a lowercase, and the context file should always start with a capitalized character. So in the shopReducer file, we will create const initial state will be equals to an object. Inside of this object, we'll have two keys. The first one will be a total, the total price of the user's cart, and we'll also have the products, which will be an array of all the products that the user added to their cart. And initially, the total will be $0, and the products array in their cart will be empty. Don't forget to export the initial state because we will need it in our shop context. Let's save this file and go back to our shop context. In here, we will import the initial state from the shop reducer file, and we'll simply pass it as an argument to our create context. Now that we have the context, we'll need to create a reducer. So let's go back to shop reducer, and right below our initial state, we'll be adding a function. So we'll do const shop reducer will be equals to a callback function. The shop reducer will accept two arguments. The first one will be a state, which will be a state object containing the same key value pairs as our initial state here. And we'll also have an action, which will be an object containing a type of action as well as a payload. Don't forget to export default shop reducer because we'll need it in our shop provider that we'll create later on. Inside of our sharp reducer, we will access the type as well as the payload from the action object, because the action will contain a payload and a type. And also, as I mentioned earlier, a reducer is a switch statement defining all the possible actions a context can perform. And it will only update the part of the global state related to that action. So we will do a switch and we'll evaluate the type of action that the context provided. Inside of the switch, let's define a few actions. By convention, each type should be a string. So we'll add double quotes, and all the letters should be in uppercase, and each word should be separated by an underscore. For example, if I have a type of action called add to cart, I will write it all in uppercase, and each space will be replaced by an underscore. So it'll be add to cart. And inside of the case, I will console log the type of the action as well as the payload. I will also return an object with everything from the state that we pass to the reducer, as well as the updated products. And we access the updated products by doing payload.products. Next, let's simply copy this case and paste it two times. We have a warning here that says that it expected a default case. So let's simply add a default case and return for now to silence this error. And now we have another warning saying that we have two of this same case. So we'll simply change them and we will want to remove a product from our cart. Let's update the console log, and the return statement will stay the same because we still want to update the products array. Instead of adding to the products array, we will be removing from the products array. And finally, we will have an update price action. And this action, instead of returning the products array here, we will be returning the total and we'll access it with payload.total. Now we'll update our default statement, and instead of simply returning, we will throw a new error saying no case for type, and then we print the type found in sharp reducer. So that means that by default, we throw an error if the switch statement can't find the type of action provided by the context. It's important to note that this error thrown is for the developer and shouldn't be seen by the end user. In other words, developers should make sure that all action types are taken care of in the switch statement of the reducer to prevent any error being thrown to the end user. Now let's go back to our sharp context, and we will be creating our provider. First, we will need to import our sharp reducer from the sharp reducer statement. So we will add a sharp reducer at the beginning and then comma initial state. Then right below our sharp context, we will be creating our provider. So don't forget to export it because we'll need it outside of this file. And we'll name it sharp provider will be equals to a callback function. This sharp provider will require one argument, which will be an object of children. A provider allows all of its children components to subscribe to the context changes. Now inside of this provider, we will be using another hook from the React library, and that will be the useReducer hook. So let's import it from the React library. The first line of our sharp provider will be this hook. So we'll simply do const state dispatch will be equals to useReducer. And useReducer will require two arguments. The first one is our reducer, and the second one is our initial state. Luckily, we already imported our sharp reducer, so we'll simply pass this. And our initial state is also already imported in this file, so we'll simply pass initial state. After adding this useReducer line, we'll need to create three functions inside of the provider. One for each action type that we added in our sharp reducer. Let's start with the function for the add to cart action. So right below here, we'll do const add to cart will be equals to a function. And this add to cart will require a product because we want to know which product to add to our cart. And we'll do const updated cart will be equals to the current array of products that we have in our state dot concat with our product. So that means that we're merging the products array with the product that we pass to this function. After we updated our cart, we will use the dispatch function from our useReducer. So the dispatch function will require an object. This object will contain a type as well as a payload. The type, you might have guessed it, is the type of action that we wrote in our reducer. So in this case, it will be add to cart. And we also have a payload, which is the part of the state that we want to update for this function. In this case, we want to update the products array. So the products will be equals to the updated cart array that we just created on line 10. We'll also need to add the remove from cart function. So we'll do const remove from cart, and we also need a product, and then we'll call the state.products.filter. And since we don't want to conflict with the product that we pass as an argument to this function, we will call the product that we're iterating through current product, and then we want to check if the current product.name is not equals to product.name. So that means that we're filtering out the product with the same name as the product that we passed to this function. Then let's save this updated array in an updated cart variable here. And below that, we need to do a dispatch, so we can copy this and update it. Instead of add to cart, the type of the action will be remove from cart. And the products is also the updated cart because we named this variable the same. And we have one last function to take care of, which is update price. So we'll do const update price will be equals to, we need to pass the array of products in this case, because we want to calculate the total amount of all the products that the user has in their cart. So we'll do let total will be equals to 0 by default, and then we'll iterate over the products array. So for each product, we want to take our total and add the product.price to our total. And finally, we will dispatch. The type of action is update price, and the payload will be simply total. Since total here is the same name as our variable in our state, we can simply do total like this. And we will want to update the price every time that we add or every time that we remove from our cart. So we can just call the update price function right after our updated cart variable and pass it as an argument. And we can do the same for the remove from cart function. Now that we have all of our three functions, we will need to return something from our shop provider. So at the bottom here, we will do return shop context.provider. Inside of the shop provider tags, we'll add the children argument that we passed to our provider because we want to display all the children components inside of this provider. Don't forget that a provider always requires a value prop, which is the states and functions that you want to be available across your components and across your entire application. Right before our return, let's create a const value which will be equals to an object. We will want the total price, the products array, as well as the add to cart and remove from cart functions available across our application. So let's do total will be equals to the state.total variable. Next, we also have our products, which can be accessed with state.products. And we also have our add to cart function and our remove from cart function. Now we just need to pass the value as a prop to our shop context.provider. We're almost there. This is the last step when creating a context, which is creating a use context hook. At the top, from the React library, we will also import our use context. And at the bottom of our file, we will create our use shop custom hook, which derives from the use context hook. So we'll do const use shop will be equals to a callback function. Then we will create a context with use context, and we need to pass our shop context to the use context hook. If the context is undefined, then we'll throw a new error saying that use shop must be used within shop context. If it's not undefined, we will just return our context. You can learn more about this part in the use context section of this handbook. And finally, don't forget to export default use shop. Now it's time to use our provider. So let's go to our app.js file. And in here, we will import shop provider from our shop context file. Then we'll wrap our entire content of our app in a shop provider. That will allow all the children of our app to access the states and the functions that we added to our value object in our provider. Now that we wrapped our entire application in a provider, let's take care of our product cart. We'll use the use shop hook in this component. So at the top, let's import use shop from the shop context file, and we'll need the products, the add to cart function, as well as the remove from cart function. So we'll do const products add to cart remove from cart from the use shop hook. Now we need to determine if the product is already in the cart. For the purposes of this tutorial, the user will only be able to add a product to the cart once. If it's already in their cart, we'll remove the product from the cart. So at the top, we'll need to import useState as well as useEffect from the React library. And then we will define a state called isInCart. Set isInCart will be equals to useState, and by default, it will be false. Right below that, we will do a useEffect. Inside of the useEffect, we want to find the product. So we'll do product is in cart, and then we'll take the product array from the useShop hook and find the product. So if the product.name is equals to the name prop that we pass this product card, that means that the product is in the cart. So if the product is in the cart, we want to set in cart to true. Else, we will set in cart to false. Now, in the dependency array here, we have our products array that might be updated, as well as the name of our product. Now that we set the isInCart state for each product, let's use it and update the UI for the add button. So let's pass the isInCart as a prop to the add button so that we can update the styling of this button depending on the isInCart state. And for the plus sign here, we will wrap it in curly brackets. So if the product is in the cart, we want to show a minus sign, else we will want to show the plus sign. Now let's scroll down, and for the add button styling, we will update the background color. So you can find this line of code in the test content below. Basically, it checks if the product is in the cart, the background color will be red, else it will be green. Now let's scroll back to the top, and we'll create a function called handleClick. So const handleClick will be equals to a callback function. This function will handle the onClick event. So if the product is already in the cart, we will remove it. Otherwise, we will add it to the cart. So let's recreate our product object here. We'll need the name, the image URL, as well as the price. If the product is already in the cart, we will call the removeFromCart function from the useShop, and we'll pass the product. Else, we will add a product to the cart, and we'll also pass the product here. Now, on the add button, we have a console log, so we will just need to remove it and call the handleClick function. Don't forget to save your file, refresh your page, and let's test this out. So let's try to add our shoes to our cart. And if you open the console log, you can see that we updated the price and also added to the cart. These console log come from our shop reducer here. We are console logging every time that we're adding to the cart, we're removing to the cart, and updating the price. Let's try to remove the shoes again. And you can see the price has been updated again, and we also removed our item from the cart. Great, now that we have taken care of our homepage, it's time to take care of the cart page. So let's head over to our cart.js file. Here, we want to display all the products in the user cart, and we also want to show the total price of the cart. For the moment, the $300 is hard-coded, as you can see here. To update this price and to also show all the products in the user's cart, we need to import the useShop hook from our shop context. And we'll also need to access the products. So we'll do products equals useShop. So we are accessing the products from our useShop hook. And now let's map through the products array. I'll simply wrap everything in a fragment, and then we'll do products.map. So for each product, and we get the index, we will show the product card. Don't forget to import the product card in your file. Then we'll use the spread operator to pass all the data from the product. And don't forget that each element in the map should have a unique key. So we add the key, which is the index of the product. Now we also want to display the total amount of the user's cart. So we'll simply import the total from the useShop, and instead of hard coding 300, we'll write curly brackets and write total. So right now you can see that our total is $400, and you can see that the shoes are indeed $400. So I will simply open this in a new window so we can see it clearly. Let's go to home. Let's add some shoes, the jeans, as well as the beanie. And if I click on cart, you can see that I have all of my three products in my cart, and my total is $650. So $400 plus $200 plus $50 is indeed equals to $650. So great, we completed our online shopping website. The final cart page displays all of our products on a product card, and we also have our updated total amount. I hope that you learned something new in this section, and don't hesitate to head over to all the other sections of this handbook to learn more about all the topics on React.